fange ihn jetzt an. Also, so yeah, I guess we're speaking English today. No Putonghua and no German. Right. Stop the music. So, right. It is 14 o'clock, so we're starting. And this is building an IoT empire. This is a 2 hour or almost 2 hour session, which is a little unusual. It's also categorized as a tutorial. So what that means, actually, I don't know what that means. This is my first time in this category doing a Linux event. In the tutorial category, and I had proposed a half day or a full day workshop. And they said, no problem. They put me in the schedule as 2 hours. So we're going to radically reduce down to about an hour and a half, and I'll try to get started as soon as possible with less talking. We don't have a network switch either. We're missing cables. We don't have the things that we typically use in the full day workshops. So there's going to be a few reductions and simplifications. The next thing to know is that this is kind of hands-on work. So if you do have a computer with you, then you want to take that out now and maybe power it up. Unfortunately, there's no tables. But if you don't have a computer, all is not lost. You can either pair up with your neighbor. You can hang out for however long it takes for you to get bored. We can play some music. And you don't have to stay until the last minute of the 2 hours in case there's other sessions or something else. Or if you get really bored, like, then you can switch. But this will be a hands-on workshop. So I'm going to do a few examples and some demonstrations, so it makes sense as well for those of you not doing hands-on without a computer, but you might want to pair up with someone, because I'll pass out some of these on loan basis, and we have some boards to work with, embedded boards. Big surprise at the Embedded Linux conference. Right, so this is my name. I think this H belongs there. Oh, that was it for the laser. Okay, great batteries there. So anyway, Michael Schloh von Bennewitz, nice long German name. You can call me Michael. My tag is not on because, as you can hear, it would interfere with the microphone. So my name is Michael, and that's my email there. If you have questions after the presentation that you've forgotten to ask, or for whatever reason, questions you want to ask in private, my business cards are right here. So you can take one. For later or for whatever reason. So I think we should get started. As I said, this is 2 hours long, but we're free to come and go as ever as we please. Let me just check what we're supposed to be doing. Okay, building an IoT empire, which kind of means we're going to be putting together, connecting embedded computing devices, sensors, and actuators. Today, mostly just computing devices together to form a giant empire, which obviously takes only a couple hours to build, right? The typical empire. And this is the proposal which I submitted, half day course. And we have a few things here. I'll try to make that go up there. So we're going to try to cover about half of this because we have a lot less time. I have embedded boards from Nordic Semiconductor and from Freescale NXP. So we can do some things with Bluetooth, probably at the end. And we'll start with some very simple UART and sensor-based RGB LEDs, and that would be actuators, and the sensors are accelerometers. We'll do some fun stuff with that. I think that's all we'll get to for today, because the MQTT and AMQP requires a either Wi-Fi or a copper cable Ethernet connection for the embedded boards. That's typically what we do, and we don't have a switch, so we might not get to that. In any case, there is a wiki for the workshop, in case you haven't noticed, I do these workshops all the time. So I'm in different cities nearly every week or at least every month of the year, Asia, China, here, Europe. I live in Munich, so I do the work there as well, and a lot in the United States. And we try to base our research and our development on a wiki that also aids in teaching. So this is kind of what we're using. And if you'd like to check it out, it might be useful as we get on into the hands-on work, because there are some tutorials and some cutting and pasting. So I don't have a whiteboard either. I do have music. So that's what we do when we get bored, right? Turn the music on. Right. I'm going to start by just showing what we typically cover in the workshop, because there are a few different board classifications. I don't really have a Raspberry Pi, but the thickest, most highest energy that we typically use are these Beagle Bones. So you can see it has an Ethernet connection. Consuming 5 volts. You probably know what these things are, so I'm going to go through this really fast. This one is the next on the high power list. I'm not sure what these draw in watts. It could be up to 1 watt. And you probably haven't seen these because they're about half year or even less old. So this is the newest Tesla board. This is a MIPS microprocessor, I believe, and uses an Atmel as well, a microcontroller for the I/O. So it's got really fast access to the GPIOs. Those are the, stupid laser batteries are out. Yeah, but I guess I can just use a mouse, right? So here are the GPIOs. It's a very unique arrangement. This is not the typical Arduino shield assembly. It's got 10 pins there and 10 pins there, and then you attach Tesla modules to that. And there's a MediaTek in the middle. I think it's running on a MIPS. It's got OpenWRT on there. So this is the Whirlwind Tour, and the last couple of devices will be the ones that we use today. But just to get warmed up, here is, let's do this one here. These two are cool because they're really small. I'll just put them both up there. And in the interest of time, I won't even take the cover off this one. That's a sensor tag. So these are things that we can use to connect together devices to form a IoT empire, right? So the sensor tag is accessible over Bluetooth. And here is another Bluetooth device, a punch through is the manufacturer, and it's called a light blue bean. I've soldered some stuff on there. It doesn't come with a piezo speaker and so on. So these are two Bluetooth devices, which are real fun to play with. We sometimes get to that and couple them up with telephones and then create new stuff with that. Today, I'm hoping that at the end we can do some Bluetooth things, or I think I have to turn it like that. So there we go. Right, so you might have seen this one as well. This is the NRF51DK, the developer kit from Nordic Semiconductor. There's a few things to notice here. This in the middle, it says embed enabled. And it's not required to have this nifty logo, but embed is what we'll be using to program these devices. If you don't know what embed is, well, we'll get to that, but it facilitates a really fast learning process and workshop. It's not unique, it's not the best for all development workflows, but we'll see that embed, it works all in the browser, at least the first generation, so it's easy to get up and running. This is a Nordic Semiconductor board, the NRF51, and it does have the Arduino shield assembly, so you can do GPIO over, I think, 5 volts is this board. No, I've forgotten, actually, but it does have a few other things, some sensors, well, these are buttons, sensing pressure, does have a matrix of LEDs somewhere too. I think if I rearrange, yeah, there, you can kind of see if I change the light a little. So those are that's a matrix of LEDs. So there's some applications you can do off the bat with this one, with just these 4 buttons and the 4 LEDs, which are user controlled. There's the LED which tells you that it's turned on is somewhere else. Right, so we'll be getting to that maybe a little later, because we're starting with one of these. These are 2 NXP boards. I don't know what to say anymore, because they're actually FRDM boards, Freescale boards, but NXP merged. The FRDM, Freescale, and I guess it's time to say NXP boards. This one on the right, I haven't brought with me because it's the same board. It just has a SDHC card and Ethernet connector, which you can't see since we don't have a switch. And there's no sense in powering that up. We do have this one. This is a KL25Z. You can kind of see there. So that's a FRDM KL25Z. And I think we can get started right away because there is actually a tutorial for that. So let's move right on. And I'm just going to click on tutorials there. Probably move that up the screen a bit. There's plenty of other stuff that's not too interesting, like start here. All right, so once I click on that, we get to this, all right? So that's the page. And while I'm passing the boards out, which please give back because we reuse them in every workshop. So I've got workshops in a week. And in Dresden, by the way, if anyone's from Dresden, you're going to the CCC Datenspuren. Is it called Datenspuren? Datenfresser, Datenspuren? I think it's called Datenspuren, Dresden. So this is the CCC conference once a year. That's what we're doing next week. Yeah, in any case, in order to get started with ARM Embed, we need an account. So if you have your computers out, then the URL is that. It's developer.embed.org. Can I make that bigger? I can write it on this here. Developer embed.org. Once you're there, you're given the choice to create an account. So that's the first thing we need to do. You can use any email address in the world. I even think you can use email addresses with false TLDs, top-level domains. So you can do like hello@hello.hello. I think that will work. They make no access control on that level. So that's what I recommend unless you want to have an identity attached with your account. And once you go there and you create an account, you will find that you have a, well, it looks like this, right? I've already logged in. And this is called, I think, the dashboard. So that's what you end up with. Oops, it's not the dashboard. After you log in, then you find this embed OS 5 page. And so please create an account, and I'll bring a few boards out. That's a mini USB. So, oh, it might work. I mean, do you have an OTG port or something? You should try. That would be really interesting to see if a tablet works. I've never tried. I mean, it's just a web browser. Everything works in the browser. So it's a long shot, it's an Apple, but still, you can try it.
Not quite.
Oh, does that, it doesn't have a micro USB? Well, okay. So there's number two, you took number three there. Okay. cable.
My colleague is getting my computer still.
Yeah, okay. You can hold it in your hand, take a look, pretend. And it requires a mini USB. This thing's taped shut. There's two ports, and one, if you look on the bottom, it says open SDA. That's the correct port. It won't damage it to use the wrong port. It'll just draw power, and then you won't have any data if you use the wrong port. But you want to use the right port? Well, there's no program on there, so if you power it, nothing will happen. But if you want to program it, then you need to use the open SDA port. And, well, okay, since we're talking about it, turn it over, and then this, that's the one. You can see that it's an open SDA port. I'm just going to mark it with the pen there. That works terrible.
There seems to be an issue with the embed server.
Really?
Yeah, you cannot sign in.
You can't sign in?
Yes. Creating a new account.
Oh, I see. Were you able to create? Yeah, okay, so sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. How about if you, there could be some cookie problem. What if you do a private window, an incognito or private window, and try again? So you've got a clean slate? I mean, it's just an idea. It would be a real shame if we couldn't get accounts. How about you? Did it work? It's okay?
But using our own Wi-Fi network.
I see.
Maybe they have rage
limiters. Huh. Maybe it's just this physical 2 meter. Okay, we'll try once more. If it doesn't work, then we'll try, I don't know. So, here's a mini USB cable. Have I been here yet? Okay, so you're welcome. Let's see. And yeah, it's mini USB. Do you have one?
Yes, sure. Oh, no, I don't have one.
Then use one.
I have a USB connector, at least.
Well, we'll be using a USB on the not to really debug it, but to program it to transfer data over. It appears like a mass data device on our desktop. Okay, I'll get some more devices.
Successful.
Yeah, I can imagine that it gave you some error, and then but you're able to go to the next screen. I'm not sure why. Well, it doesn't matter. They require an email address, and that's that. But I don't think I gave you computers yet. So, take 9 and 10. And you'll need mini USB cables for that. So there and there. There you go. Oh, yeah.
Is this the right one?
No. You can use that one. You probably have one there. No, it doesn't look like you do. That's a mini USB. That's the next thing to realize. Do you want a device? You can try it if you have a OTG.
No.
Okay. All right.
I have another.
Oh, you have another? Do you want to try it? Is it working for you? And you can download it, can't you? So who knows? It's a nice experiment. So what? In case you're wondering, what we're trying to do for the first time is use really computers that you never develop on, like Apple iPads, right, or tablet computers, to flash firmware onto these embedded computers. So it's a nice, I don't know, I guess if you get good at it, you know, you would have a backup for the road if your computer goes broken like mine did. That's why I have two. Anyway, so I think everybody has an embedded computer now, a KL25Z, and we can get started then. So first things first. So you see that, where I'm connecting that? It's OpenSDA. That's the bottom of it. On the top, it looks like this. So, and then that's the LED that turns on to tell you that you have power. Did I miss you? Do you have a, do you want one?
You can use mine, but I can't put it on.
Ah, okay. And use that one. Fine. So I'm going to switch monitors because my USB system is fried on the Windows. So let's see. Switching monitors. You can probably guess why we take a full day for this workshop when it takes 10 minutes just to pass devices out and cables and everything else. And then we're waiting for the video. There we go. So good. So there we are here. And because I plugged in my computer, the FRDM KL25Z, it gives me a USB mass storage target on the desktop. You might have noticed that, a window pop up, right? This is a very unique workflow that, well, it's actually part of the ARM SimSys DAP communication between the USB and the internal storage. But it's kind of a unique workflow, which is a little difficult to get used to. You don't find any programs in here, but this is where we're going to drag and drop the firmware that we create, right? I'm just going to double click this embed.htm file, because I believe that's a good way to, okay, so I'll have to sign up first. It's a good way to configure our account. So after you double-click that embed.html file, you get a little documentation about the computer you're using. This is pretty common with all of the embed-enabled or embed-compatible platforms, which we can check out if we go up here to hardware and boards. Just have a little fun and see what kind of things work with the ARM embed development framework. And there's quite a lot. Blah, blah, blah. There's maybe a few hundred. What I like to do is go to the left and then reduce the selection so that I can make sense of it. If I just click on NXP semiconductors, then I don't get so many and I can find the computer that I'm interested in. And that's another way to get to the same page we had before. I click on that and I end up there at the same page. Right now, that's going to be important because we want to add this device to our ARM embed account. That's what's here on the right. There's a button there that says add this device. Because when you, let me go back to the login. If you actually do some compiling, you'll need to select a target. You might have five devices connected to your computer, right? Five FRDM targets or something like that, and you can select them over here on the, I can't use this pointer. You can select them up there. And right now it's got the KL25Z there because I already have added this to the platform, but you don't have this. You probably have an empty list here on the left. So you'll find something like no device selected here on the right. In order to be able to select a device there, you need to add it. Does that make sense? Has everybody added the KL25Z to their account? I see. When that comes up in the web browser, it's added automatically. Perfect. There's actually quite a lot of nice features that that they've thought ahead. You can tell they're thinking ahead when they create this this HTML file. If you take a look inside, and there's some hidden files as well. Anyway, so you don't have any projects here on the left. As you can see, this is what it looks like when you start to get your work done. Right? You've got My Programs, and then below those are all the different projects. But to get started, because I think we're all on the same page, are there any problems or questions so far? Is everybody comfortable and they've got an account, everyone who's got a computer? So why don't we try this? Let's just create a new program. Let's make sure the thing is working. If we look at the, I don't have the camera on now, but if you look at the board, it just has a LED telling you that it's powered, right? So let's make the LED blink to make sure that there's some communication, that everything is on track. So I just selected new program, and then I can choose one. Now, I have quite a few targets here, so I'll be very careful to select the correct one. You just have one. And the one right at the top, Blinky LED Hello World, is pretty much the easiest example to choose. You can rename it here, so I'll call it ELC Blinky. And this is kind of an important check mark here. In most cases, or at least in the very easiest examples, it doesn't matter if you have it checked or not. What it means is that any library dependencies that you're using, like if you're using an accelerometer or some complex devices that are attached or the GPIO assembly, you can use a library in order to avoid writing 4,000 lines of code. And then you access the accelerometer using three lines of codes, right? And when you check that, it will find the newest version of the dependencies and download those, not paying attention to what the original developer intended. The original developer might have written this program 2 years ago and then stopped maintaining it and hard-coded things that only worked with the library 2 years ago. And if you update the library and it's got all kinds of new features, then your program will break. It'll probably break at compile time, right? So there is an option to not refresh the libraries so that you're using the ones from that time when the developer made the program and uploaded it. Because this is also a cloud framework, so a lot of these projects are everywhere and you just pick and choose and you download them. I usually leave this checked because it's nice to have fresh libraries, right? So I'm going to say okay, and that's going to download source code from probably Cambridge, wherever ARM is. I don't know where their servers are. That's where their cloud servers store all of this framework. And there it is here, ELC Blinky. So you'll find that on the left. You can take a look at it. It's all C and C++ code. So the ARM embed platform doesn't support Python, doesn't support JavaScript, unfortunately. But that's kind of uncommon anyways for embedded computers, right? Anyway, so that's what it does. You can already see it's very simple. It just keeps looping and then identifies the LED you're interested in and then does a wait and turn on, wait and turn on. Incidentally, be very careful with these values. Like zero turns it on. It will have a bright light if you set the LED to zero. So there's a lot of people work hours long trying to figure out I'm turning it on by using one, and then you know at the very end of a long day they figure out, well, I should have just used a different value. So don't make assumptions with that. In any case, the next step, if you're following along, so just click on compile. And what this will do, the source code is in our browser right now, but it will send our source code back up because obviously we could be modifying it, right? And then it will send our modifications back up on the cloud, and now I'm saving it. And then it will compile that on their build farm, the ARM embed build farm, wherever that is. Maybe it's Cambridge. After that happens, it sends you a binary. Like you can see here, they very ingeniously called it a .bin file. Great. And so they're going to send that back to us. So there's all this this back and forth. Which is involved, that's kind of maybe one of the weaknesses because you need to have a stable internet connection. You usually do anyway. So I'm gonna make sure I remember what this file is called. That's pretty important. I'm gonna save the file and then I'll have that on what? On downloads. Right, there it is. So yeah, we're gonna skip all of the typical, let's look inside the file and so on, and what kind of headers it has. But so the thing that we want to do now is just drag and drop. I'm going to drag this over to the embed target. Just put it right on there. And remember that there's nothing inside here except for these two things. And you might expect later on to see this thing that you drag over there on there, but let's watch and see what happens. The one thing that's maybe a little important that I recommend, take a look at this LED while you're dragging and dropping. That's the indicator that's telling you the transfer is correct. You'll be seeing it flash if your data is correctly moving across the USB cable through the SimSys DAP interface. Because in some cases you've got it plugged into the wrong computer or some other thing can happen. So I'm just gonna drag and drop, see how that works. And then it should be blinking, right? Magic, exactly. And then it returns me back to the finder or the navigator or whatever you call these things. And I look in there for this ELC Blinky file that I just dragged and dropped over onto the USB mass storage. And if I had put a typical thumb drive in there, I would expect it to be there. And this is what is so unintuitive. The ARM embed environment will bring the computer down, or at least the USB mass storage portion of the circuit, after a successful transfer. What it does then is format the DOS file system, which then comes back up, and then it gives you this fresh work area to drag and drop again, for example. But you can never inspect what was happening on there before. It will always format it and then give you a fresh chance. So what I have on there right now is this ELC Blinky binary, but it's not working yet. We can see that nothing is blinking. That's also normal because I haven't instructed it to restart its processing cycle yet. So it's a very funky workflow, but you do get used to it. Now, I'm gonna just push on the reset button, and I think, my camera's not connected, but you can see LED probably. So then the RGB LED starts blinking red, right? I can see that a few, okay. You're a little bit farther on. We might wanna speed up. Any questions? Looks like it's a bit of a challenge with a flimsy tablet no keyboard and no real USB environment and so on. But good. So that was that's the basic Hello World that you can try with any board. Almost any board has a blinky application. And we could talk about it. We could, I mean, why is it red? This is actually RGB LED. And this identifier LED1 corresponds with the red color of this three filament LED. Right. If we click here on the right, the way I'm doing now, we can access the pin out. We can get some information. I think over here somewhere is the LED1. I can't find it just now. Here it is. So you see that there? We're using the LED1 identifier, and it corresponds to just one of those filaments, to the red one. It's kind of documented a little bit messy there, but yeah, it's not too obvious. So there's LED1, LED2, and LED3, and you can guess why there's three of those, right? Because RGB. So you can access them independently. Anyway, so. Right, so I got that by clicking here to change the target at the top right. It's kind of a multifunction button. You click on that and it tells you you can select a platform, you can add a platform at the bottom, you can change to another one, and then it's got the documentation and the pinouts. I mean, it's pretty well laid out. ARM Embed is impressive in a lot of ways. It's, yeah, so they're moving towards, they're changing the platform quite a lot. This is the older generation that we're looking at now, everything that's done in the web. And they're doing a lot of work to do Python-based CLI, command line interfaces and stuff like that. So this is not the only thing that you can do with ARM Embed, and it's not for everyone, for every application. There's obviously, you know, they're competing with Kyle, with IAR, the IAR workbench. There's some Eclipse plugins as well, the GCC on the command line. You can do with any of those things the same thing, program these embedded computers, right? In any case, there are a couple more interesting examples to do with the FRD MKL25Z. So now that we've got it blinking, we know it works. Let's try another. So we know how this works with this new button, right? New program. Let's take a look at what's on there. We'll make sure that the KL25Z is the one we're working on because each category has different examples. These examples are provided by the vendor. So in this case, the vendor is NXP Freescale. So my assumption is that the vendor creates these programs, these examples, and as part of the offering, the ARM Embed offering, they send those to ARM, they're certified or whatever, and they are integrated into the platform. This is not always the case. We can use programs and projects that anybody else has created and uploaded to the cloud. So there's not just like 20 example programs for the KL25Z. There are many hundreds, but we'll take a look at that later. And incidentally, that's when we use the import button instead of the new button. But this is new. This is all from the vendor, so we can be very confident that these things work out of the box, right? And there is a pretty cool one. I'm just going to go back to the tutorial because I might have to cut a few corners, and I don't want to get too far behind. So this is a pretty awesome one because then we're using both sensors and actuators, right? And that's the name of the accelerometer that's on board. So that's what we'll do next. How about it? Incidentally, you can go as fast as you want. You don't have to go at the same pace as we are because for some people it's a little slow. So do you see this example there? It says example program for FRDM boards with a Freescale MMA 8451Q AC. That's an AC accelerometer. In some of these, you can see this one ends with of. They're just cut off, right? So it's not perfect, but it's good enough. So I'm just going to select that, the one that says MMA 8451Q. There is only one example, I think, with the MMA 8451Q, the accelerometer. I always like to name them where I am, so we'll call it ELC Excel. And I'm going to keep that checked, because this one does have a library dependency for using the accelerometer code. And so I want to just make sure it's the freshest, most up-to-date, feature-rich library. Right? So it's going to download that from ARM's servers. And we'll see how it looks. OK, there it is. Have it on the left. And there is the dependency that I was talking about. So that's what got updated to the newest version by clicking on that checkbox. There is always this dependency. The embed dependency is always there. So you can't make a program without the embed dependency. It's giving you your basic, your framework for everything else. Things like serial code, that's serial output, and so on. In this case, I think we have serial output, so I'm glad I just mentioned that. This is an accelerometer example, and I opened the main HCPP file, which is the only source code file there. Basically, at the top, it's using one source file for a bunch of different platforms, like Freescale NXP creates a KL46Z device. Here's the one that we're using. And the identifiers are a little different for each one, if you look at the pinouts and the architecture. Right, and that's it. So we're obviously not coding too much, and that's why we need that library to do the work for us. So this is going to be print out to the serial console there, which you can, it depends on the platform. If you're using a Linux, you can do a CU command. I don't know if I don't have that on here, but you can even do a cat from TTY, whoops, S0S1, or is it ACM? There it is. So that's my device. That's what came up. If I detach the KL25Z, I will lose this ACM zero device. That's the serial device that my Linux computer is giving me when I connect the USB port. And if you have a Windows or a Macintosh, it'll be obviously a little different. The one thing to note, if you do have a Windows device, Windows computer that you're developing on, you need drivers then. You don't get any serial output. I don't even think you get a serial device when you connect these ARM embed computers to a Windows computer. It's not too difficult, but because we don't have time and we don't need to read the serial output, we're not going to do too much debugging. We'll just skip that. Right, in any case, what we're doing in this example is reading the X, Y, and Z axes from the accelerometer. So this means if we turn the board around and do things like this, it will be sending different values out, and we print that to the serial port, and we change the RGB LEDs to different colors as well. So I'm just going to compile that, and that will send my code up to the cloud, compile it on a remote build farm, and then send me the completed binary back. As you can see here below, it says success. In some cases, you'll have to debug if it the build breaks. So there I am. I got the download, and that means I can drag and drop. Here it is. I had Blinky before, and now there's my ELCXL binary. I'm just going to drag that over here. How do I? Anyway. So, and it's blinking, so that tells me that it's transferring. And then I get a fresh new file system, a DOSFAT 32-bit file system. So I won't know if it worked yet until I click on the reset button, right? So let's try that. What do you think? You think it'll work? Wow. Well, that's cool. I'm going to turn it upside down. Anyway, so that's using the accelerometer as a sensor and the RGB LED as an actuator. So that's kind of the all-in-one hello world, the easiest possible hello world that you can do using a sensor and an accelerometer and an actuator, right? I mean, I guess you could do a push button. That would be even easier. But we don't have those things on board. And this is actually a specialized accelerometer. The MMA8451Q can detect vibrations as well. So it can give us special indications of if there's a vibration of a certain length, like however many milliseconds. So it's a special accelerometer. It doesn't have 9 axes, so it's not valuable in that sense. But because it does have a couple extra features, like the vibration detection, we can do fun things with that. In fact, I think there's one. Okay, there's a pretty cool example. I'll show it to you. But we can't use new, because new just gives us the ones from the vendor, right? We've just got a few things, and there's only one with accelerometer. So I'm not going to use new, but I'm going to create a new project. I'm going to import. See that button there? We haven't pushed that yet. If I push import, then it gives me a different way to search for programs. So I'm going to do something really cool. This uses the accelerometer to detect vibrations, and it's called Secret Knock. So I'm going to search for that over here. You have to be connected to the internet. Whoop-la, maybe. Oh, because libraries, it's not a library. Exactly. Let's try that. I don't have anything bookmarked. Yeah, you can see that you can choose a tab there. Anyway, so here's a secret knock. Over here on the right, as soon as you click on this, you get some information about it. Usually you get a list of things, right? And you can click through them, and you can find the one, like some of them have more imports, so they may be more mature, more well-used and tested. But this one is the only one in its class. So I'm going to import that by clicking on this button right here. See that? So this is the second type of taking code from other people. I guess that's, I don't know, that's a bad, sounds bad, but in fact, this is all open source code. So what happened? Did I import it? There, okay. So at this point, it looks very similar, and I'm just going to call it ELC knock, right? I'm going to choose to update all libraries. I always do that, you know, I update the libraries, the dependencies, and then if the build breaks, then I go back and import it again without choosing that. This is kind of the way I prefer to work. I like new things, new libraries, new dependencies. So I'm importing that now. It's stored on the same platform, the same servers, probably in the same data center as the build farm. And there it is. So now, this was my old one, and here's the secret knock. Looks very similar. It has a dependency to this MMA8451Q, the accelerometer that's on board. It has an embed dependency as well, which is required, and it has a main CPP file. If we take a look in there, now I'm stacking up tabs here. I guess I can close the old ones. So it has a little more code there, because what it's doing, it's actually detecting a song. You know, there's a little more logic. So we can't see it all on one screen, but even so, it's a couple hundred lines of code. It's what, 350 lines of code. So it's not an insane thing. You can actually understand this in 10 minutes if you read it. All right, so this one is gonna be a little bit difficult to experiment with for us in this room, but but let's try it anyway. I'm gonna compile this and push it over to the device. Now this is going to require some knocking because the accelerometer is on board, and there's a few challenges to that because there are rubber feet which dampen vibration, and you can, another thing that I found works is when you don't have a surface, like we actually don't, you can just lightly tap on the side. That typically works because we need to detect vibrations for this one, the ELC knock sample. So save file, I'm just going to remember what it's called and where I'm putting it. So don't get lost. And there it is, ELC knock. I'm going to drag that over here. I have to make sure it's there. So let's see if it transfers. Yeah, it's transferring. Looks good. And as usual with our embed, I always have to push on reset before it starts to work, right? And so, just a small explanation, is green. It starts green always, right? And when it senses some kind of accelerometer signal, it will turn blue. It's reading, trying to detect vibrations while it's blue. And at the end of its reading period, which is some fixed value, it will either give you a flashing red or a flashing green. So there are these three phases, blue at the what was it? Green at the beginning when there's no action, no activity. You make a tap or do something, it turns blue. It's reading, it's detecting taps and vibrations. And at the end, it tells you if that was a correct secret knock, blinking green, or if it's not, blinking red. Right? So I'm going to do this secret knock correctly, but you probably don't know what it is. It's called, if you read the source code, it's in there. It's called shave and a haircut, 2 bits. Do you know that one? Some of you are probably coming from England, right? Shave and a haircut, 2 bits. So I'm going to wait until it starts the cycle over again because it's reading. It takes a few seconds. Okay, it's going to be green. So shave and a haircut, 2 bits. Okay. So shave and a haircut, 2 bits. I'm going to do it on a table. That might work a little better. Shave and a haircut, 2 bits. Okay. So it works better on wood on a table if you can put it on your knee. I don't know how. Yeah, usually we have tables. So you probably have to be very exact if you tap. I don't know. I can't magically make tables appear. You can. The one thing, this is very interesting. So follow along here. I'm going to eject that so I can disconnect it. And the program is on there. It doesn't disappear, right? So you take a battery out. This is pretty cool. And if you'd like to test it on wood, you don't know how because your computer or whatever. I'm just going to power this. So, right. And you can just bring it over here, for example. So that's one option. Now we're going to screw the alignment of the projector, right? Shave and a haircut, 2 bits. Yeah, so it's green. So that's very useful. It doesn't have to be connected via a data cable. It just needs power. And you could do some other funky power management by attaching a battery or whatever. The one thing I did forget to mention, most of these NXP FRDM boards from Freescale or from NXP, they do have, you don't see the headers on here, but they're Arduino shield assemblies, right? So you could solder headers on them. For a lot of the other boards, they actually already have headers on them. Like, where is it? Here it is. Like, here's another one. I'm just going to pass this around because it's a different one. You might want to take a look at it and compare the two. You can see the plastic headers on that one. That's a K64F. This one's much more common because it's more versatile. Has an Ethernet connector on there. Costs a little more as well. I think these are $15. These KL25Zs are very inexpensive when you consider the RGB, the beautiful RGB that it's got, and the accelerometer with tap detection, all these features. $15. And I think the K64F, which is with the Ethernet port, I believe they're upwards of 30 or so, but I'm not completely sure. So they're pretty cheap boards. And obviously, the whole purpose of this, I mean, NXP is not trying to get, 400 people around the world developing on these things. They're trying to sell the individual chips on there. They're actually not even interested if people buy ARM chips. They want to sell NXP chips, right? That's an NXP board. So at the very end of this whole long story, when you're doing this for a couple months, a couple of years, you end up with a project, with a product, which you use a pick-and-place fabricator machine or reflow or so on. You make your own boards, your own circuits, your PCBs, using the chips that NXP sells you. And they want to get the ball rolling by sending these boards out for these cheap prices where they make no money, right? So that's kind of, people ask sometimes, why is it so cheap? Or, I mean, how can I put this in a watch? Well, you could put a lot of these chips in a watch or in a small belt buckle or something, but you would just have to reflow the circuit, put it on a PCB that makes sense, and cut out the Arduino shield assembly and all the stuff you don't need. Right, so I'm not sure how much more we can do with this one, because we have about another hour. With 2 hours, I don't know if we want to take a break. It would be a good time to take a break. I'm going to go through one more example on the KL25Z, and then we'll get started with the Bluetooth board. So if anyone wants to make a call or get something to drink, it's a good time for that. So. So let's see what we have on tutorials. So we finished the secret knock and the accelerometer. There's a few more cool things. Right, so, I'm not going to do the demo. I don't think we have time. But it does have a capacitive sensor on there where you can place your finger. You can actually slide and create logic. It will be in software. But you can do gesture detection because the slider is not just a simple on-off switch. It detects a position of your finger or whatever capacitive surface is placed on there. I'll say it real fast. There's a example called TSI slider input. This is one of the official ones. And if you do that, which is just here, it's one of the official ones, then you can see that the LED changes intensity. So if you try that one and you slide your finger across, the LED will change its intensity according to which place on the board you place your finger. So that's pretty cool. I mean, when you think of a $15 board, you don't think of all the stuff that it would have, but it's pretty cool. Good board. Right. So you can keep going with that. You can go crazy with this board, but there is another, which is, I don't know if I should switch computers. Not that one. There's this one. So that's what I'm going to pass out now. Maybe we should pass out some beacons. Yeah, the description did mention beacons. So I'm not sure. I've got a bunch of estimate beacons here. So we might as well take a look at how a finished product works. Yeah, I think I'm going to switch back now. Okay, so what I showed before, what I showed before was this NR51 board, which we can mess around with in just a minute. And basically, can I get them both on there? Right. So you can see the difference in size, and if you look, you can't look inside because these things are encased in plastic, I guess to make them waterproof. I'm actually not sure. So you can't take them out, the logic and the PCB out. You can't replace the battery, which is stupid, right? It lasts a couple years or maybe even longer, depending on how you configure the signal strength and a bunch of other things, how fast the beacon broadcasts. So that's the thing over there, and it's very small, but the thing that makes that work, what's inside is the I forgot the exact name of the chip, but it's the same thing that's making this NR51 board work, and I believe it's, I can't see it now, it's not the big one. It could be, this could be the actual Bluetooth circuit here. It's kind of hard to see. But if it is, you can imagine that would fit in there. So that's the whole purpose of this development on these developer kits, right? The developer kits are not a finished product. In any case, let's take a look at some of these. These estimate beacons. Let's see, well, it doesn't matter what number it is. So you might notice I'm handing them out upside down, but because they have an accelerometer inside as well. Oh, okay, just take those then. Okay. It's you can read the values off of this, the battery level and the acceleration and so on, using a mobile phone application. So that's why it makes sense to. I've got a bunch more, but I've got to find them. Where are they? Do you want one?
Can I
use it? Yeah, you probably can. You can probably, it depends a little on the platform, on how you access the data.
But I still have to make an account in embed.
No, we're not, for these beacons, because it's a finished project, finished product, we're not going to develop them, we're going to configure them. Actually, we're not even going to do that. We're just going to read the values off of them. And I just, I never know if people have ever seen a beacon, so that's why I hand them out, right? I assume some of you know what these things are and how they're used. So I've got my beacon there, and the way that I like to use them is with the mobile phone. Oh, that's great. Sideways. This is not going to work too well. First things first, I'm going to change the... So there's actually, you know, it doesn't matter if you have Windows Phone or Android or whatever, or iOS. You've always got beacon applications or at least some kind of Bluetooth smart, Bluetooth low energy accessor application. I've got a few different ones here. I've got this physical web at the top. I've got Estimote, which is the manufacturer of these. That's probably the one I'll use, but there are a few others. There's NRF Connect, which is probably the most useful. That's the one from Nordic Semiconductor. And there's even a few others like, this one here, Beacon Manager at the bottom. Well, if I put it up there. There's Beacon Manager, there's Sensoro. Every manufacturer has their own application for beacons, but because these are generic applications, in order to help a developer get started or to just access a beacon to configure it, you can do a lot with any of them. Like probably if you choose Sensoro or Blesh beacon, you can access the RSSI value from these Estimote beacons. So they're kind of compatible if you want to think of it that way. So Estimote wants you to use their application to get started developing on this, and that's how it looks. If I click on devices at the bottom, it probably will show nothing. I have done two things with these beacons. If they are upside down, the accelerometer realizes that, and it shuts off the transmission. It turns off the transceiver so that I can fly on airplanes and have a good, clear conscience, because I fly with 100 of these things, you know. So they're gonna slide my suitcase just right under the pilots there, and we'll see what happens with the plane. I don't like that feeling, so I turn them off when I'm on the plane. I try to make sure that they go on. You know, there's a this side up on my luggage, and then they're deactivated. Anyway, so that's what the accelerometer is good for. You can program it and tell it to shut off the transceiver. So now I will turn it on, because now it's right side up. So that's how it should be when it's transmitting. And the second thing that I've done is I've reduced their transmission power to the absolute minimum for two reasons. Well, you could say it's to increase the battery life If you can't replace the batteries, so it's nice to have a long battery life. The real reason I've done it in our case is when we have a room full of 100 students or even 10 or 20, and all of them are transmitting at full power, then you have no idea if you're doing anything right or if that's your neighbor or something else, right? So I've reduced the power to a minimum. You pretty much have to put them right on the phone. You pretty much have to do this, right? And then you see it. You see that? So that's mine. And because I've reduced the power to a minimum, I won't get any interference from anybody else. So I can either configure it or I can read off the battery level and do all the things I want to access it with without fear of, am I doing this right or is that my neighbor? All right, so those are the two things that you can try. You can choose some application. If for whatever reason you can't install the Estimote application, I'm not sure if it's available for all platforms, try any beacon application. I'll go one more step with this one. And whoops, that's not what I wanted. That's what I wanted there. So this is basically telling you what beacon format it's using. I'm going to turn this light off. There are two common formats that you find most of the time in new beacons today. That's the first is well, what we have here is Eddystone. That's the symbol for Eddystone there. And the other one is iBeacon. So Eddystone is kind of what's the word for that? Well, Google is the one that made took your iBeacon, the format, and kind of turned it into Eddystone. So that's what a lot of Google devices, applications, and documents refer to, the Eddystone, which gives you the option to transmit a URL as well. And the other one, the competing standard or format, is called iBeacon, and it just transmits a UUID. I don't know how many bits it is. And that's the one that Apple kind of whatever maintains. Eddystone is a little more open, so but it's also a little more power intensive because you're transmitting a full URL, transmitting telemetry as well, like temperature, acceleration, and battery. And there's some things to consider. The URLs can only be 14 bytes long. For that reason, to keep power down to a minimum. So these packet lengths are not being fragmented and you're not sending more packets than you need to, keeping the protocol simple as well. So 14 bytes, that'll be important for us later on because if we have time, we'll be making our own beacon. The next thing you can do with these beacons is try another application, for example, like this one is pretty good too, NRF Connect. And I believe it's available on at least three platforms, Windows Phone, iOS, Android. So it's pretty much everywhere as well. I'm going to click on that. And this is how it looks. So it's finding a couple other things around. I doubt they're beacons because they're transmitting with such low power. Those are probably, I don't know, headphones, stuff like that. Yeah, that's something else. So these EBs, those are the Estimote beacons. And the other stuff, the 527A, I'm not sure what that is. Not bonded. And any case, so that's the one that I have. And it's telling you right there that it's a physical web beacon because it's encoded with a URL and it's using Eddystone. If we click on that, we can get more information. Whoops, I can't click on that with a mouse. Because it's a mobile phone, stupid. Okay, so there's an Eddystone URL, which that's weird. Doesn't show up there, and it does show up there. I'm not sure why. In any case, there's not much more to say. It's just now you know how what kind of features typical beacons have.
Beacon?
Yeah. Oh, did it? Did, maybe I didn't. I think somewhere I do. Where did I put them? Here, take that one. I have three more somewhere. So I have three more here. And All right, so then if I go back, and I scan again. Oh, I know why it's, there we go. Yeah, another thing, you sometimes have to re-scan, or it's not always scanning. Typically, these applications scan for 10 seconds and then they stop, and then they require human input to keep scanning. It is a little power intensive, so they try to keep the battery fresh that way. If you stop scanning, right. Anyway, so this is actually useful for a few other reasons. It gives you the RSSI value in text, right? So typical beacon applications will tell you that you're this far from the coupon, whatever, the product that you can use a coupon for. You know, it's just right around the corner or something like that. But for engineers, it's helpful to know, you know, have values like DBI values or RSSI values, which aren't exact either. RSSI is not part of any of these specifications. Like RSSI is a value that Wi-Fi transmitters will give you as well. But it's not specified, I believe, in the standard. The most... Let me make sure that I'm not 100% sure about this, but I believe that most vendors specify one RSSI at one. How was it? So if you place the, if you set the transmitter of a beacon to transmit at one dBi, place it 1 meter away, it should measure one RSSI or something like that. So if you take a few different manufacturers and vendors and analyze their RSSI values, they kind of revolve around this value, and you can see that it does. Yeah, I think we can move on from there. There is a particularly interesting application if you have an Android phone. I think iOS has it now as well, which is not working for me, but you can try it out. And that's this physical web application. There it is. I'm just gonna click it to show you what it should do, and you'll see that it doesn't work on my phone. Searching for beacons, right? No beacons found. I'm not sure why it doesn't work. It did work about 2 months ago. But the coolest thing about this is that it's emulating a real physical web phone with Bluetooth Smart and Eddystone logic in the kernel, or at least in the core modules of the phone. So that Google envisions a world of phones where this is all in the core. I'm not sure why they just don't do it off the bat, because they control Android. But the typical use case for physical web beacons that rely on Eddystone is that you walk up to a device, to a tree or anything that's been implanted with a beacon, and your telephone will start vibrating. You take the phone out to see what's going on, and there's a notification that this is the right tree to cut, this is the wrong tree to cut, you know, whatever the beacon is signaling in that case. And you have a web application that backs this all up. So you get the URL. The mobile phone resolves the URL and pulls data off the web application, and then presents that to you in a notification. That's the way that Google envisions the physical web, and they rely on Bluetooth beacons to do that. So with more time, we could create a physical web. We typically have enough beacons to place around the room, and then we walk around. But you get the idea, at least, and you can download applications to try it out. Now, we do have enough time, I think, to attempt to create our own beacons, because what more fun can there be than to actually, instead of having these plastic encased things, to look at the PCB and the circuits and plug in with USB and create things, right? So that's, I think, what we'll do now. If it's okay with you, I'm going to unplug here. Go back over there. I take that back. I need the camera. So these are the devices now that we'll be working with. Now I need the light again. Where did I put that thing? Oh, here it is. So these are the devices we'll be working with now, and we need different cables as well. Don't try to plug these devices in using the cables you have, because they're not mini USB. They are micro USB devices. Too bad there's not a third option. Wouldn't that be great? Like mini USB, micro USB, nano USB. I would just love to have more options. Yeah, I guess there are more options. Wonderful. What I mean is cables that look exactly the same, right? But they don't fit. Ja, das wäre gut. Ja, das wäre gut. The reason I'm as soon as this, oh wait a minute, this session ends and another session doesn't start right away. We have a coffee break in between, so there's no danger of going overtime. Oh, that's great. Usually it takes a while to tear down, so that's why I'm thinking maybe I should collect the old devices, but it doesn't matter. Okay, you're going to try out? I think there's enough for everyone, so there's a micro USB this time. Oh, you don't? Okay. No computer? Okay.
10:04 ended this session.
Eine was?
10:04 ended this session.
10:04, genau. Und dann haben wir bis... was 4:30 mit dem Kaffee. Ist das nicht so?
Ja,
und that's when I'm going to be tearing down during the coffee break. Yeah. So, there you go. You just need one?
Yeah.
You have one computer? And this is a embed platform, as you can see from the marking. Cable. Sure. You want 3, 2, or 1?
Thank you.
I'll get 3. There's enough for everyone. And here are 2 cables. 2.
None of these. Mine, right?
I think.
Far, like 6 meters, 7.
That's weird. I don't.
How do I enable it?
It's enabled now. And it should. So it ranks them in the order of RSSI. So, do you know where the antenna is?
I think it's there.
Look, one just came up. I think it's that one.
So the meter is, or, oh.
And wait a minute.
Less than a meter, this one is. This one probably.
Let's see, I will block it with my hand. 2.4 gigahertz is the transmission wavelength frequency of Bluetooth, and it's blocked very easily with water, so all you need to do is put your hand on it, and it will be blocked. Yeah, I'm actually not sure which one it is. I don't recognize those identifiers. Oh, you already have three. I thought I gave you two.
One.
Oh, yeah. So that's, you're the one without.
Okay, the cable.
So. What is it? Yeah, you can leave the old ones. Did I already pass by here? Yeah. Yeah, you can leave the old boards, the ones that we used before, plugged in if you have enough USB ports. You'll just need to be careful to select the correct platform in that case. Otherwise, unplug and replug the new ones. Once you plug the new, they're not new, they're the Nordic boards in, you'll find that they don't turn on. That's because there is a power switch here, right? So you have to turn the power switch on. These have a power switch, the others don't. Each computer, you know, has a few different features. So, and next to the power switch is this reset button, which is so important when we want to start a new program to get it running, right? Okay, so I'm gonna switch to the other computer because I don't think I can connect with this one. There's something wrong with the USB. System on this. There we go. So I just plug that in, I'm gonna turn it on, and I've got a green light. Very nice. And then we get a window as well, just like I think all embed hardware platforms, you get the same thing. A window comes up, USB mass storage is presented, and the name is embed. So I'm just gonna double click on there like I did the last time, and I think it will be a different computer this time. Yep. NRF51DK. And if things are as I think, then the on the right, you, instead of having a add platform, it's already automatically added. I like that feature. Right. So a lot of this will be the same as we saw with the FRD MKL25Z from NXP, but this is a different manufacturer, a different platform. We're not using accelerometers. We're using Bluetooth Smart. Why? Because Nordic Semiconductor is the world leader in Bluetooth smart chips, right, and semiconductors. They don't have their own fabrication labs, and they don't do Bluetooth Classic, which means Bluetooth 1.1, 1.23, and Bluetooth Extended Data Rate, EDR, HDR, all of these less modern, more high power, and higher throughput versions of Bluetooth. So once you, if you have a dual stack where you have the classic and the Bluetooth Smart, then it's not made by Nordic Semiconductor, but Nordic Semiconductor is kind of, I think, not monopoly, but they make quite a lot of Bluetooth Smart circuits. So any devices like heart pulse sensors and so on, they have a lot of circuits from Nordic Semiconductor, like we just saw with the SDMO beacons. You find them anywhere, everywhere. And this is what people use to develop for it. So if I go back to my environment here, then I should see that I have here at the top right a, yep, there it is. Oop, no, there it is. Nordic NRF51DK. And I'm going to have to select this as a platform that I want to target my programs for, because possibly if I don't do that, it will still show the wrong platform up there, and I'll be building binaries for an XP platform and transferring them to a Nordic Semiconductor platform. Believe me, that doesn't work. It won't damage anything, but because the circuits are different, you won't get the results that you plan, right? You probably will with things like serial output, because, well, I'm not sure. I haven't tried it, but most things won't work. Anyway, so I'm going to close all this. And the one thing you can check out is some of the docs. Pinouts are here, same as before. It's a little different features. Talks about firmware updates. And then you have your pinouts. Yeah, pretty nice. So let's see what they offer as far as the vendor-supplied examples. Make sure that I have the right platform selected, Nordic NRF51DK. And I think I'll just make sure it works. I'll test it with a Hello World, ELC, NRF Blink. I'll keep the update this program selected. And pull some sources that I can then refer to, read, and don't know. Oh, I see. Yeah, this image directory is new. I think this is for the new. Yeah, this will be interesting. I'm sure it'll work, but this is all for the new generation of the ARM embed framework, which you can do, which you can program with on the command line as well. It's really nice, but I just hope they keep maintaining their web-based stuff. So here's the. That's even more simple because they're not assigning values; they're just flipping it. Right, so I'm going to compile that and then drag it over to this device. What I do notice is that the new generation of ARM embed, that the embed dependency is much bigger. It's taking a lot longer to compile. There's just more stuff in there. It's probably not using everything. It's a smart compiler, so it'll just throw things away that we don't use. But it needs to analyze it. Okay, so ELC, NRF, NRF Blink. And it's useful that it adds on this NRF51 for me, so helps to keep things sorted when you have different computers. So let's go here. Oh, I've got too many of these. I just want to. Okay, so that's my NRF51. My downloads is here, and there's the NRF51 blinky. I'm just going to drag that over. Drop that and watch the LED to make sure it blinks. Yeah, it's transferring. The reason I mention this so every single time is that there are quite a few problems with Windows and USB, and in some cases this disconnects or it will not transfer correctly, and then you're wondering why it doesn't work. Well, your code is correct. You don't need to debug it. There's some problem in the USB subsystem of Windows. And it depends on if you have Windows 8 or Windows 7 or Windows 10 or Windows 10 anniversary. So it's just nice to know when it transfers correctly. So I wonder what happens if I reset now, because the program hasn't started yet. So I'm just going to click on that reset button. And it's not the LED that tells you when it's transferring and when it's turned on. You can see there's a matrix of LEDs up here, and it will start blinking one of those. So if you've created this this program correctly, transferred it correctly, and it was made for the right platform and so on, then that's the correct output. This is what should happen, right? So that's what I always do when I have a new platform. I make a blinky Hello World application for it, and that's working, so we can move on. I'm going to close that. And like I said before, if you set an LED to zero in one platform, it could turn it on. In another platform, it could turn it off. It's the manufacturers read those values and implement and interpret them differently. So I'm actually not up to date as far as what Nordic provides ARM with these examples. I'm just going to take a look here at everything that they have. Like this one is a new embed OS, what we just tried out. That wasn't there about 2-3 months ago. Let's see. So we have, this is probably an interesting one. What can we do? I'm interested in this one. I wonder. Yeah. So I'm going to try this URI beacon example. There is an Eddystone example somewhere, but I'm not sure it's stable. It's kind of contributed. And what I assume, I'm trying to keep things straight here because there's been some changes, but this URI beacon, it's very similar to Eddystone, so you can change the URL and it will behave as a beacon. So that's actually what we had in the description of this session, is that we can make our own beacon, and that's kind of what I mean by that. Once you have a beacon working, you understand how the code works, then you can remove all of the stuff that you don't need and then create a nice Estimote style plastic encased PCB, which is a beautiful product, right? But the sky's the limit. There's a lot of things you can do with beacons. So I'm going to call this ELCNRF URI beacon. And this will get a little tricky because this example, I'm not sure if it's going to be real easy to lower the transmission power. So we're probably going to be radiating out to Brandenburg. So okay, not that far. We've got, what, theoretical physical limits, 30 meters for Bluetooth Smart, and you usually get about 4 meters or 8 meters. So, but that's quite enough. If we have this 5 meter boundary, that we're gonna have a lot of interference. So what it might be smart to do right off the bat, I'm gonna look for a URL in here. I'm gonna change that. HTTP will not be part of the URL because the HTTP is encoded. Shut up. So I thought it was embed.org was the URL that they used as a sample. Oh, I see something here that we need to adjust. Do you guys see that 60 there? So this is, it's going to wait 60 seconds before it transmits. This is the configuration period where it's going to accept input from a connected Bluetooth device. And we want to, I mean, I'm just going to reduce that to 1 because I'm not sure if 0 means actually 0 or forever it's waiting for input. Right, so that's actually important, and I wanted to change the URL, but I don't see it. Search for what? I mean, is that the URL? Config service. It's only URI IC, but it's ridiculous. Oh, I think I know why. This is URI beacon. So in the Eddystone profile, all of the protocols are encoded. You don't write that as text, right? So the first byte of an Eddystone beacon transmission is not H or something like that. It's not an ASCII encoded byte character. It's a value. It's a 1 to 256, and it can be any of HTTP, HTTPS, FTP, and a few others, right? So, but URI beacon is an older protocol, and they weren't, it seems that they weren't encoding that. In any case, I'm going to change this right now. And I'm going to be careful and make that something that actually exists, because Eddystone has some rules about that, let's say. So I'm just going to say Linux. No, you have Linux Foundation. It's too long. This has to be 14 letters, right? All right, that's a good one. Okay, so that's nice, and that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. So I think it's 10 is probably the... Yeah, actually, I haven't read the URI beacon standard. In Eddystone, that's what counts, and it has to be 14 or less. Okay, so default advertised power level. I wonder, I would like to make that minimum, but I don't know what the identifier is for that. I'm just going to compile because this is taking too long. And we'll see if I get something from arduino.cc. So that went rather fast. That's probably not the new generation embed library. Okay, so I'm going to save that. And there it is, beacon. Right, so I'm going to drag that over, drop it here, make sure I see if that's transmitting correctly, and it looks like it is. And once I press on reset, it will be advertising this URL using the URI beacon standard. So I'm going to press reset right now, and we don't have any visual indication that it's working or not working, but if I take out a telephone, yeah, and change over to the camera, then we can check it out. So that's the one I want, NRF Connect. And let's see if we find something. Probably it's the first one. Not entirely sure. No, that's a company Apple. That's not it. What's this here? UR beacon config. Is it in configuration? Is that the one that I have? It doesn't look right. Maybe I have to get it closer? No, that can't be it. With what? Yeah. So maybe I just needed to scan again? How about if I try looking for it here? There are a lot of ways to troubleshoot. So I'm pretty sure that this MURI beacon config is the one. In fact, if I'm going to just unplug it and see what happens. So I'm now going to unplug the board. I ejected it first. It's not that important. And I'm going to scan. Now, Arduino, Android is notorious. It takes sometimes forever, half a minute or so, to give you new devices or to erase old ones. So sometimes you have to be patient with it. Yeah, so it finished its scan loop and it didn't find this crazy M configure device that it had before. So I'm going to say that's the one that we were programming here. So I just plugged it back in so that it's working again. If I scan now, I think it will probably... Yeah, brilliant idea, Apple, for identifying people by their name. Advertising, broadcasting people's private identities over Bluetooth. So scanning. Or the very many trials of embedded development. And now it's not showing up. So I guess I'll just go back here and try. Try scanning again. So what happens if I connect to that? Disconnected. No, it's not going to let me it's not going to let me connect. I don't know how that happened. Why is it connecting to all these different devices? So try one more scan. All right. That's not working. And we need to move on. We just got about 10 minutes. So I'm going to try one thing that I do know works, at least partially, which is an example that's not very well maintained. I just fell down. But it works a little better. So I go back here. So there is not Eddystone, this is URI beacon as well, but there's an example which not only encodes, but it works. And it's called physical web. So I'm going to search for that. I've got the correct platform up there already. And this is the one here. So if you compare the results, this one only has 18 imports, that one 199. So it could be a little bit better, well tested. It is a little old, so it's not not actively maintained. I'm going to call this ELC FiWeb. And I believe the last time I tried to update those libraries, the BLE, the Bluetooth low energy dependency, it didn't work. So I'm just going to leave that unchecked for this one. Import that, and then I'm going to try compiling. I think it'll work. I'm now seeing more than one MURI beacon config, so that's probably means that people are having some success with that example. Right, so here we have our new project, the physical web. It's got a few hundred lines of code. And I believe somewhere there's a 60 second, 30 second, I'm not sure where, I'm gonna say 60. Second configuration period. Anybody see that where the... Yeah, but I think that's timing the pulses, the transmissions. That's 1 second. That's just fine. What I'm looking for is where it configures for a certain amount of time before transmitting. And I guess it doesn't have it. The other one did have it, in any case. So what we have here, you see that there, this zero? That's the indicator for HTTP www. So you don't have to type all that stuff out. This is an encoded value. And then all you have to type out is the URL. So the URL is set to embed. And I'm going to make it... I'm just not very creative today. Hello. I'm sure there's a... hell. Helly. So there's another place too. There is a place here down below. There is another place where we configure it. Hi there. So it's going to say either hi there or helly. All right, I'm going to save that, compile, transfer, and that should work. So this one is FiWeb. Here's a binary that I just created. Nordic Semiconductor has decided that that the binary should be called HEX instead of BIN. I guess that's a vendor-dependent identifier, how they label their generated files. And so we have this one. I'm just going to drag that over. Let's see if it's transferring. Looks good. And once I press on reset, then it should be easy to see. So I hope it works this time. Cross your fingers. Wonder if we can use the physical web application now with this one. Haven't tried for a while. Oh, still can't use that one. Okay, where are we here? Which is the one that we're interested in? Minus 83, minus 78, minus 95. Weissnet, welchen MAC address? Scan. Let me look again here. Oh, not offline mode, you idiot. Thank you. Doesn't look too good. You try it from a battery. Yeah. You do? Which application are you using to see it all? Oh yeah, and it's working. Okay, great. I guess it's working. I don't know. It's, you know, sometimes you can't tell if it's the phone Bluetooth stack or something else in the phone or the board itself, but it seems to be working. Whoever else is trying this this example out, she's reading it from somewhere, and she's got the heli
URL.
Okay. Yeah, a non-Google product. Well, that's fine. It's a Google protocol. Yeah, in any case, so we have, I think, 5 minutes or something. We're actually supposed to finish up now. But we have succeeded in creating a few beacons, right, using these NRF51DK boards from Nordic Semiconductor. So that's kind of the culmination of the Bluetooth portion. We usually can do a lot more with some penetration testing and defense and attacking the Bluetooth stack with a variety of other devices. So there's plenty more here. I was just reading the Linux Foundation training catalog yesterday. They have a few classes, and they're all like 4 and 5 days long. And I was thinking, oh, we can do everything in 4 days. They're always cutting back. And so it's kind of disappointing that we can't get into security, because securing Bluetooth communication is very important, obviously. And they have very, very good and robust secure PIN codes and methods to secure those communications. So that's the Bluetooth portion. We started with the FRDM KL25Zs. And for the $15, you can imagine what you get with that: these capacitive sliders, the RGB LEDs, the accelerometers, and a bunch more with USB and so on. So it's not a bad deal. See you later. And that's pretty much all that we were able to cover today. We would have gone on into internet protocols like MQTT, AMQP, if we had time, and if we had a switch and some more equipment and more time, but we didn't do that. Incidentally, in the evening at the showcase, I'll be teaming up with a few guys from different companies, and we'll be doing things with the Arctic 10, the Samsung Arctic 10, and we're doing MQTT and more or less on this level with embedded computing, but with internet protocols. So that's kind of what we would do if we had more time. And yeah, that's all that we have for today. This is, how do I get this thing out of the way? So we started with that. I don't really have slides, but if you take a card, I may be able to get slides online of some kind. And yeah, thanks a lot for coming. It's now coffee time, coffee break. And if you want to see something really cool, which looks like this, then come by the showcase later on, have a drink, and then we'll chat about the embedded mobile IoT lab, right? Which I'm going to take out. It's actually right here, but it's covered up. All right, so are there any questions about ARM embed, the USB, SimSys DAP communication, the workflow, about beacons in general, or the transport, Bluetooth, smart? How about, I'm sure there are questions. If you have questions, the Primo.
Runs the NRF52. It's not out yet, but I think you'd like it.
Oh, okay. Wait a minute. The NRF52. Yeah, I think I have that over there. It's but it's, is it called the Primo? Or is it called the Genuino It's not the Uno, right?
No, it's a Primo, and there's a Primo Core. It would be the classic border, just the BLE. The Primo is a regular dev board, and the Primo Core is
the... I see. So the one I have is the one with the Intel Curie and the ARC chips on there. What is that called?
That's the
101. That's a 1, right? 101. Yeah. Okay, so that's nice to hear that they're doing more with Bluetooth, and that's how the Primo looks?
Cool.
Yeah. Yeah, so the boards we were using are NRF51, and there is a newer model, there's a 52, and that's what she's referring to. 52 has NFC on there as well. It's got a few different features.